A very good morning to all. So students, while we were talking about some protozoal infections in the previous classes, today we will start with some classes on helminths, which are some interesting group of parasites. So for the first lecture today, we will talk about intestinal nematodes 1. We will cover major nematodes responsible for human disease. So what do you understand by the term helminth? So why was the term, the helminth term coined? So in Greek, helminth means worm. So these, all of these nematodes or all these helminths, they just look like worms. So that is why they were named as helminths, and they became to be known as helminths as a class. All of them are multicellular parasites. All the helminths have a bilaterally symmetrical body, and they have three germ layers. So these are some things which are common to all the helminths. So before you start with learning about helminths, we should understand how do we classify them, because that will make things a little simpler. First of all, helminths can be classified into two major phyla which are responsible for human infections. First is platyhelminths, which is also commonly known as flatworms. The other group is nemathelminths, commonly known as roundworms. So based on their body structure, they can be broadly classified into flatworms or platyhelminths and roundworms or nemathelminths. Now, platyhelminths or flatworms, they can be further classified into two classes. One is trematoda, the other one is cestoda. So amongst the flatworms, we have two classes. So how to differentiate them? We see the differences in the structure again. So trematodes do not have any segmented body, while cestoda, they have a segmented body. So that is how they are different from each other in gross morphology. When we talk about nematoda, all of them are roundworms. They have a rounded body structure. Now this table gives a summary of the differences between the cestoda, trematoda and nematoda. Nematoda is the topic we are going to talk about today in today's lectures. So all of the nematodes have elongated, cylindrical and unsegmented body structure, which is different from cestoda and trematoda, where in cestoda you find segmented bodies, while in trematoda they have unsegmented body. Both cestoda and trematoda are flat, as we have seen, while nematoda are all having a cylindrical or rounded body structure. In terms of sexes, cestoda are all monoecious or hermaphrodites, while trematoda again are all of them monoecious, that is hermaphrodites, except for schistosomes, which is an exception where you find male and female sexes are separate. In nematoda, the sexes are separate for all the nematodes which are responsible for human infections. In case of nematodes, there are no suckers or hooks present, which may be seen in the other two classes. While alimentary canal is complete in nematoda, it is either absent in cestoda, or it is, as in trematodes, we can find them, they have an incomplete alimentary canal without any anus. In terms of body cavity, both the other two classes, cestoda and trematoda, do not have any body cavity, while nematodes have a body cavity present. So in terms of evolutionary structure, you can say that nematodes are more advanced than cestodes and trematodes. This is again a slide which actually again talks about the same things we have talked in the previous tables. Just to highlight a couple of changes or differences from the earlier slide, the size of the nematodes can vary from as small as less than 5 millimeters, and they can be as long as around 1 meter long. And their body is covered with a tough cuticle, which helps them to tide over the environmental situations. So as I said, alimentary canal here is complete, anus is present. It is different from that we see in trematodes and cestodes. And as for nematode, you will find that males are generally smaller than females. So when we talk about any nematode, generally males are smaller as compared to females, and the males generally have a posterior end which is a little curved or coiled ventrally. Now female nematodes may be classified into different categories based on the way they give birth to their young ones. So they could be either viviparous, where they give birth directly to larvae, for example in case of Dracunculus medinensis or guinea worm, in case of Trichinella spiralis, in case of lymphatic filariasis causing nematodes such as Wuchereria bancrofti and Brugia melae. In all these cases, the worms are viviparous. While they are oviparous in most other nematodes, such as Ascaris lumbricoides, Trichuris trichiura, and hookworms. So here they will lay eggs, which will further mature to form larvae and then adults. The third group of nematodes belongs to ovoviviparous worms. The classical example is Strongyloides stercoralis. Now this worm releases eggs, it lays eggs, but they hatch immediately after they are laid. So when you find, when you see the specimens in, of the patients, you will find the larval stages and not generally the egg stages, because eggs are going to hatch immediately when they are laid by the worm. Now for most nematodes, when we see the life cycle, man is the optimum host for nematodes. Trichinella spiralis is something where you will find that pig is the optimum host and man is an alternative host. So here man may not be the optimum host for the parasite. However, even here worm will pass its entire life cycle in the same host. So the worm is capable of completing the life cycle in the same host. So that is how there are many common features which are present in the nematodes when we see it as a class. Now life cycle is possible in one host except for some superfamilies such as Filariidae and Dracunculoidae, where you will find that intermediate hosts are involved in the life cycle. Otherwise, in other nematodes, it is possible for the worm to complete the life cycle without the requirement of a second host. Only one host is enough for the parasite to complete this life cycle. For all the nematodes which have only one host, parasite will localize in intestine. So wherever you will find that nematodes have a habitat in the intestine, generally it is only the single host, and it generally the man is the optimum host for these worms. And now what are the modes of infection? Now nematodes can be transmitted by various modes of infection, the most common being by ingestion. It could be either the ingestion of embryonated eggs of some nematodes such as Ascaris lumbricoides, Enterobius vermicularis, and Trichuris trichiura, where you will get the infection by ingestion of eggs which have been embryonated. While growing embryos in an intermediate host, so an embryo which is there inside an intermediate host in the life cycle, that may act as a infective stage or may act as a mode of transmission for some worms such as Dracunculus medinensis, also known as guinea worm. While encysted embryos in the pig's flesh, in the infected pig's flesh, is another way by which a person can acquire infection, for example in case of Trichinella spiralis. Now other way by which you can get the infection with nematodes is by penetration of skin. Now this way of causing infection is seen in hookworms and Strongyloides stercoralis, which have many things in common, but these two are the worms where you can get the infection by the larvae penetrating directly through the skin or mucosa. Now other way of transmitting infections by nematode is by blood sucking insects, for example in filariasis, where mosquitoes act as vectors for transmitting this helminth from one person to another. Another route which is less often seen is by inhalation of infected dust. This can happen when the air is having some suspended eggs of these worms, and by inhalation the man may get the infection, for example in case of Ascaris lumbricoides and Enterobius vermicularis, because here what happens is the eggs are lying in the soil, and because of the air currents it may become suspended in the air, and that is how it may be inhaled, and subsequently the person may become infected. Now intestinal nematodes can be further classified according to the habitat, because we are going to talk about the intestinal nematodes today, so it becomes simpler if we talk about these worms in terms of their habitats. So there are some nematodes, intestinal nematodes, which have their habitat only in the small intestine, and this includes Ascaris lumbricoides, Ankylostoma duodenale, which is also known as it's a kind of a hookworm, Nicator americanus, which is again a hookworm, Strongyloides stercoralis. So all these have a habitat only in small intestine, and we are going to talk about these four today. The other two are Trichinella spiralis and Capillaria filipinensis, which again have their habitat in small intestine only. Now some of these nematodes may have their habitat in the cecum and vermiform appendix, that is primarily in large intestine, and these two are Enterobius vermicularis and Trichuris trichiura. तो दीज टू हैव देयर हैबिटेट प्राइमरली इन सीकम एंड वर्मीफॉर्म अपेंडिक्स. सो वेन एवर यू वॉन्ट टू गो फॉर द डायग्नोसिस ऑफ इंटेस्टिनल नेमेटोड्स, इट्स ईजी टू रिमेंबर दिस चार्ट बिकॉज इफ यू वॉन्ट टू डायग्नोज द केस ऑफ इंटेस्टिनल नेमेटोड्स यू हैव सम अप्रोचेस टू फॉलो. सो वेन यू परफॉर्म ए स्टूल एग्जामिनेशन यू मे बी एबल टू डिमॉन्स्ट्रेट लार्वे इन स्टूल. So when you find larvae in stool, unless proven otherwise, it should be a larva of Strongyloides stercorales. While you may find eggs in the stool also, now this is a possibility in case of some worms, and you can differentiate these eggs again based on their bile staining character, which basically refers to the brownish coloration of the shells of these eggs. So the brownish colored eggshells will be seen in some worms such as Ascaris lumbricoides and Trichuris trichiura. So if you see a bile stained egg, you should think about Ascaris lumbricoides and Trichuris trichiura as a possibility in case of nematodes. Now when you find non bile stained eggs, hookworms and Entrobius vermicularis, which is rarely seen in stools, these are the possibilities when you find non-bile stained eggs in stool samples if you are considering nematodes as a differential. Third possibility is to demonstrate the eggs on the perianal skin. Now for some of the worms, particularly if you talk about Entrobius vermicularis, here the eggs are laid around the perianal region, so they stick in this area. So if you sample this area, the perianal region, and examine under the microscope, that sample may be able to show you the eggs of Entrobius vermicularis, which are non-bile stained eggs. So all these eggs have a different morphology, and when we talk about these worms, we will talk about the differences as well. So this is how you should approach your diagnosis for intestinal nematodes when you are examining stool specimens. So either larvae in stool, which generally represents Strongyloides stercorales, you will find eggs in stool, which could be bile stained or non-bile stained, or you will find eggs on the perianal skin, which usually belong to Entrobius vermicularis and they are non-bile stained eggs. Coming to our first nematode for today, this is an intestinal nematode and one of the commonest worms we see in humans, Ascaris lumbricoides, also known as the common roundworm. I suggest that you also remember the common names for these worms because they will give you good information about the worm itself. Now, when we talk about the geographical distribution, it has a worldwide distribution. Particularly, it's present in tropical zones. Its habitat is small intestine. The habitat basically refers to the area where the adult worm is going to reside inside a host's body. So it's a small intestine, particularly jejunum, where you will find the adults of this worm in the human body. These worms do not attach to the intestinal wall. They maintain their position inside the lumen by way of their muscle tone. This is how they will stay inside the intestine without attaching physically to the wall of the intestine. When you see the morphology of this worm, they have quite a resemblance with earthworms. So you may sometimes confuse it with earthworm. It is the largest intestinal nematode which infects man. This is another thing which you should understand. This is the intestinal nematode and it is considered to be the largest intestinal nematode which infects man. When it is fresh out from the intestine, it generally has a light brown or pinkish tone to its color. Now gradually with time it changes to white in color. So when you see these worms, the color may vary depending upon the time which has passed after it was excreted with the feces. Now the anterior end of this worm is thinner as compared to the posterior end, and mouth, when you examine it closely with the help of a hand lens, you will find that they have three finely toothed lips, which is one dorsal and two ventral, which may help to further identify this worm, because there is another worm which is morphologically identical, which is seen in pigs and gorilla, it's also known as Ascaris suum, and this worm can rarely cause human infections and they look very similar or identical to the Ascaris lumbricoides. So the only difference which can help you to say whether it's Ascaris suum or Ascaris lumbricoides is that in case of Ascaris suum, you will find triangular teeth, while in case of Ascaris lumbricoides, teeth have concave sides. So if you can examine that, that should help you to differentiate between the two species. As I said, males are, for all nematodes, are smaller than females. Here again, males are around 15 to 25 centimeter long by 3 to 4 millimeter wide, while tail end is curved ventrally, as with other nematodes. Here again, the tail end of the male worms is curved ventrally like a hook, or it's bent in other nematodes. The females are longer. They may range in size from 25 to 40 centimeters with a diameter of around 5 millimeters. A characteristic finding in the female worms is the presence of vulvar waste, which is a kind of a concentric depression here in the body, which is present generally at the junction of anterior and the middle third of the body where vulva opens. At this point, if you can see an adult worm and you can find this structure, that should help you to say whether it's a female Ascaris lumbricoides or it's a male Ascaris lumbricoides. Another interesting point to note is that mature worms can lay approximately 200,000 eggs per day. So this is a huge number. So if a person is infected and the eggs are being passed, so you can very well imagine how rapidly it can spread its eggs into the environment and multiply the number of persons who are infected in case of poor hygiene. Now, some important stages in the life cycle of Ascaris lumbricoides include the egg stage, which is a fertilized egg, and other one is an unfertilized egg. Now, here we are seeing the fertilized eggs of Ascaris lumbricoides, which act as, after they become fertilized and embryonated, they become infective to the man. Now, these are round or oval shaped eggs, as you can see here. Their diameter is around 60 to 75 meter long, and they are around 40 to 50 microns in width. They are bile stained eggs. Their shell is brown and they have a thick translucent shell. So their shell is thick and it's bile stained. You may see there are some rugosities on the surface, also known as mammillations or outer albuminous coats. Now, this albuminous coat is again a feature you may find in the eggs of Ascaris lumbricoides, and this may vary in fertilized and unfertilized eggs. Sometimes this outer coat is lost during transit through the intestinal lumen. Now, when they are moving through the lumen, because of the friction, it may sometimes lose its outer coat, and then it looks like this, and you call it a decorticate egg because you are not seeing now the mammillations. Inside, they have a large unsegmented ovum, and in a fertilized egg, if you find these crescent shaped areas at the poles, these empty areas, this helps to say objectively that this is a fertilized egg of Ascaris lumbricoides, because it clearly differentiates an unfertilized egg from a fertilized egg. Now, this slide shows the unfertilized egg of Ascaris lumbricoides. There are some differences which help you to differentiate them from the fertilized ones. They are narrower and longer, so they are narrower as compared to the fertilized ones, and they have a longer dimension here. Approximately 80 microns by 55 microns is the dimension which you will find them. They are again bile stained, with the outer coat having a brown color. However, the shell is thinner as compared to a fertilized egg, and their albuminous coat is not also that well defined. It is an irregular albuminous coat. Also, you will find a small atrophied ovum here with a mass of disorganized, highly refractile granules present all over. So these features will help you to differentiate a fertilized from unfertilized egg. Another interesting point to note is that this is one of the heaviest helminth eggs which are present in human infections. And when you try concentration methods, in the flotation techniques, it is not going to float because of its high density and weight. That is why it is going to sink down. So flotation methods will not be helpful to concentrate these unfertilized eggs, while sedimentation techniques are useful here again, as with most of the eggs of Helminths. So as with most nematodes, there is only one host for Ascaris lumbricoides as well. Humans are the only definitive host for this parasite. There is no intermediate host, and we acquire the infection by ingestion of embryonated eggs. So embryonated eggs are the infective stages for the human beings. The fecal-oral route by which you generally acquire the infections. And one point again to note is that freshly passed eggs of this worm are not infective, because they require some time in the environment, during which time they become embryonated and they become infective to the next person. So there is some time gap before they become infective, after they are passed with the feces of an infected person. So further development in soil leads to formation of rhabdity form larvae in the eggs of these para, in the eggs of these parasites, and then they become infected to the new host. So once these embryo-related eggs are ingested, they reach the duodenum where the rhabdity form larva is going to hatch out. Further, what happens is, we will talk about this in the this diagram. So in the small intestine, females will lay eggs, they are passed out, they become embryonated in the soil. After their ingestion by the definitive host, they reach the small intestine. The rhabdiform larva hatches out, it will penetrate through the tissues of the intestine and enters into the bloodstream. So it's not a direct kind of parasite where it goes to the intestine and matures into adult. It follows a circuitous route where the rhabdiform larva will first penetrate the intestinal lining, enter into the bloodstream, and from here it reaches the lungs via the right heart. The right side, from the right side of heart, it will reach the lungs. After it reaches lungs, it will enter into the bronchioles and bronchi. These larvae then further move into the bronchi and trachea. They reach up and they are then again coughed up and then re-swallowed. So this is how this rhabdiform larva, after it reaches the lungs, it's coughed up, it's actually swallowed again. And then it reaches the intestine where it develops into adult worms and it starts laying eggs thereafter. So it's a circuitous route it follows. And during this process, while it's migrating from the intestine and reaching to lungs and reaching again to the digestive tract, it undergoes changes and multiple moltings to finally develop into adult worm. And this life cycle is similar in both Ascaris lumbricoides and Suam, or the only difference is being in terms of definitive host, where man is rarely infected in case of Suam, and Suam being a more common infection seen in pigs and gorillas. Now the clinical features of this worm may be attributed to different stages of this worm. So some of the symptoms may be attributed to the migrating larvae. So when they reach lungs, they can elicit a syndrome known as Loeffler syndrome, which may be seen in case of heavy infections, which is a kind of eosinophilic pneumonia, where the presence of larvae elicits a host response leading to the infiltration of eosinophils and subsequent clinical manifestations. Now in these cases, sputum is often blood tinged and may contain larvae, so you may be able to demonstrate larvae because they may be present during this stage, but it's not always possible to demonstrate them. Also, when the larvae are in journal circulation, they can be seen in various organs and they can lead to unusual presentations. For example, if they are present in brain, they can lead to neurological manifestations. Accordingly, spinal cord as well, they can lead to neurological manifestations. They may be present in heart or kidney. So depending on the site, they may cause some mild clinical presentations depending upon the site which is involved. Now, what is Loeffler syndrome? As I said, Loeffler syndrome refers to pulmonary eosinophilia. It leads to respiratory complaints due to passage of helminthic larvae through the lungs, and that is how the patient presents to you. So it's an eosinophilic reaction to the migrating larvae through the lung tissue, and here you will find the eosinophilic infiltration, subsequently releasing various enzymes and toxic granules and other agents that are actually aimed at killing the larvae. And during this process, inflammatory response is elicited, which leads to clinical manifestation. Now for Loeffler syndrome, Ascaris lumbricoides is considered to be the commonest cause. However, it's not the only cause for Loeffler syndrome. It's a classical cause of Loeffler syndrome. There are other worms as well where you can see this syndrome, which presents as pulmonary eosinophilia. For example, in case of Ascaris suum, in case of infection with hookworms, infection with Strongylodes turcorealis. So in all these cases, there is a possibility of seeing Loeffler syndrome. But in case of larvae migrating through the lungs, it's not common to see the pulmonary eosinophilia or Loeffler syndrome. Most of the patients will remain asymptomatic. It's only in some cases where the patient may present with features of Loeffler syndrome. So the patient may come to you with cough, dyspnea, wheeze, hemoptysis and respiratory distress, which are non-specific respiratory complaints. So if you have a doubt in your mind based on the raised eosinophil count or maybe chest x-ray demonstrating patchy area of consolidation, so you should have a differential in your mind about this syndrome as well. So what you have to do is, to confirm your diagnosis, you have to demonstrate larvae in the respiratory secretions or in the gastric lavage fluid. This is not always possible, but if you are aware about this, you will go for this test and maybe you will be able to demonstrate the larvae and may help many patients. The management is generally no specific treatment is available. However, corticosteroids may be tried in severe cases, so we don't have any definitive treatment protocols. However, you can try corticosteroids in severe cases. Antihelminthics will not be of much help with this parasite in case of larval stages of Lowler syndrome. They are useful only if you expect that the worm has matured into adult phase. So only for the adults, the antihelminthics have a good efficacy. For larval stages, they may not have any good effect. Now, when the adult worms are present in the gut, you can have again several symptoms depending upon the damage they are causing. One of the way it causes damage to you is by its spoliative action. The spoliative action, it means that it robs you of your nutrients. So basically it's consuming the nutrients we are taking by taking up the nutrients from the intestine. And by this it contributes to protein energy malnutrition. Now this is the way by which it is going to affect your health. The other thing could be allergic manifestations. This could be due to the body fluids of Ascaris released into the tissues. Now this can lead to allergic manifestations. The other effect of Ascaris is a mechanical effect, which is again an important way by which it causes clinical manifestations. It can lead to intestinal obstruction if this large number of parasites are present in the intestinal lumen. It can lead to intestinal obstruction. Even perforation is possible if they penetrate through some ulcer points, pre-existing ulcer points in the intestine. That is something which is again of high concern, because perforation can lead to peritonitis and serious complications. The other way ascariasis can present is as ectopic ascariasis, where it may enter into the stomach and may be vomited out. This is also seen sometimes, that the patient vomits out the worm. Also, it may pass up through the esophagus at night and may come out of mouth or nose. So this is again a very fearful sight, where the patient is sleeping and he may observe that worms have come out of the mouth or nose. The worm may enter the respiratory passages. Now, if this happens, it can lead to suffocation. The worm can also cause appendicitis in case it enters into appendix. Because it's a large worm, it can cause obstruction and can initiate appendicitis. It can also lead to obstructive jaundice depending upon the ducts involved, or even pancreatitis. So all these manifestations are possible with the Ascaris worms. Because they are large size, they can move, and depending upon the site involved, they can sometimes lead to serious issues. Now these are some images, as we were talking about in our previous slide. You can see endoscopic image where a worm can be noticed inside the lumen of this intestine here. Similarly, this is a case where during surgery a part of the gut was resected, and you can see it is full of worms. So it has caused obstruction, which required this removal of this part of the gut. Now this is an image where you can see the worms coming out of the mouth or nose. So this is a dreadful sight. So this is a thing which is possible with Ascaris. So it can happen in case of heavy infections. So how to approach the diagnosis of this worm in the laboratories? So we can have direct evidences where we can demonstrate the adult worm. Now we can find the adult worms either in the stool or in the vomitus. When we administer antihelminthics, it may lead to expulsion of the worms. This is another way by which you can see the adult worms. So if you find adult worms, it should be easy to confirm the diagnosis here. But the more common way of diagnosing ascariasis is by demonstration of characteristic eggs in the stool or the bile of the patient. Stool examination is the most common investigation by which we demonstrate ascariasis. We look for the eggs of this worm. Sometimes you will find larvae in the sputum. That is more commonly seen if a person is having respiratory complaints and suffering from Loeffler syndrome. So here larvae can maybe demonstrated in the sputum samples. Now there are some indirect evidences available in the form of serological test. For extra intestinal ascariasis, here you can try using some serological techniques like ELISAs, so by which you can demonstrate the antibodies to this worm, but however it doesn't confirm an acute infection. So you have to correlate with clinical findings, and other diagnostic approaches have to be followed to confirm your findings. Serology is also useful when you suspect the patient has Loffler syndrome, so here again serology may be of help. On blood examination, eosinophilia is present, but this is present only in the early stages of invasion, and it's again a non-specific finding, so it's not a way by which you can confirm the diagnosis, but it may give you a clue to the diagnosis. Now, how to treat ascariasis? So we have many good anti-helminthic agents available, including albendazole, mebendazole, and parenteral bimavit. All these are good options of treating ascariasis. In case of complications such as obstruction, surgical intervention may be required, or endoscopic removal may be required for treating the case. For prophylaxis, as with most intestinal nematodes and intestinal worms, hygiene is very important. It's very important that there is a proper disposal of human feces so that it's not contaminating the water and food sources. Treatment of infected patients again is going to cut the transmission rates. Creating awareness and education of children is very important again, because it will help in maintaining hygiene. So finally, it's a proper hygiene which has a big role to play in many of the fecally transmitted helminth infections. Coming to our next group of nematodes today, that is commonly known as hookworms. Now these hookworms have their habitat in the small intestine, particularly in jejunum. They are less often seen in duodenum and rarely in ileum. So jejunum is the most common site where you will find them, as is seen with the ascaris worms as well. There are two main hookworms which are responsible for human infections. One is Ankylostoma duodenale, also known as Old World hookworm, and the other one is Nicator americanus, also known as New World hookworm. So these are the two major hookworms which cause intestinal infections in human beings. There are other hookworms as well, for example Ankylostoma brasiliensis, which is primarily responsible for infections in dogs and cats, and the other one is Ankylostoma caninum, which is primarily responsible for disease in dogs. So these are two worms which are mainly responsible for disease in dogs and cats. However, they can cause in some cases they may cause accidental infections in human beings, and that can lead to another condition which we are going to talk about in the subsequent slides. So amongst the hookworm, Ankylostoma duodenale is the more common one we see in India. When you see the morphology of this worm, again the adults is the first thing you should understand when we talk about the stages. They are grayish white or pinkish colored worms. They have a slightly curved body, and the anterior end bends in the same direction as the body curve. So for Ankylostoma duodenale, the anterior end is bending in the same direction as the body curve. When you see the buccal capsule, it is large and well developed, and it contains 6 teeth. You can see here the teeth. They have 6 teeth in the buccal cavity. 2 pairs of curved teeth are present ventrally, while 1 pair of knob-like teeth are present dorsally. So this is how you can very well differentiate Ascaris lumbricoides, Ankylostoma duodenale from Nicator americanus worms. Here again, males are smaller than females. The males are just around 8 mm long, as compared to females, which are around 12 mm long. In case of males, the caudal end is expanded and forms an umbrella-like structure which is a prominent copulatory bursa. In females, there is a genital opening at the junction of middle third and posterior part of the body. So this is how, again, you can differentiate male and female worms of Ankylostoma duodenale. On the other side, the other worm, which is again a hookworm, is Nicator americanus. Here the adult morphology is very characteristic again. These worms are little smaller than the Ankylostoma duodenale worms. They have a slightly curved anterior end. The anterior end is little curved here again, but then this direction of bend is different from the body curve. So body curve is like the body curve is happening like this, but the head is bending on the other side. So this is different from ankylostoma duodenal, where they bend in the same direction. And the buccal capsule, if you can examine, that is very helpful in differentiating ankylostoma duodenal from Nicator americanus. So whereas in case of ankylostoma duodenal you find 6 teeth, here you find 4 chitinous plates. So instead of teeth like structure, you have plate like structures, 4 chitinous plates. So this thing, if you see, you can differentiate this from ankylostoma duodenal adult form. Now when we see the eggs of hookworms, they look identical under microscope. So you cannot differentiate ankylostoma duodenal eggs from Nicator americanus eggs. They will look identical. So when you see eggs, you just say that they are eggs of hookworms. You cannot say confidently that they are Nicator americanus or ankylostoma duodenal. However, both are oval or elliptical structures. They are non-bile stained. They have a transparent hyaline shell membrane. They contain a segmented ovum, which may be 4 or more. So they have a segmented ovum. Their wall is very thin, unlike Ascaris, which has a thick shell. It's a very thin wall with a clear space here, with a segmented ovum here. It's a non-bile stained structure. The shell is transparent. Then the eggs, when they are passed out, as with Ascaris, they are not infective when they are freshly passed out. They again need some time in the environment before they become embryonated and infective to next host. Eggs, as I said, are morphologically similar to Nicator americanus eggs and indistinguishable by light microscopy. Coming to the life cycle, here again we don't require any intermediate host for the life cycle to be completed. Humans are the only definitive host for hookworms, and the infective stage here is not the embryonated egg. However, it is the phalariform larva which is the infective stage. The mode of infection here is not generally fecal-oral, it is percutaneous. So here the larva is going to cause infection by penetrating through the skin or mucous membranes, which is similar to what we see with strongyloides. So they are going to penetrate through the skin and cause infection. So how it happens? So basically, when an infected person is having this worms in the small intestine, they will start laying eggs. These eggs are passed out in the soil with the feces. They undergo further development. Rabidiform larva develops inside, it hatches out, and subsequently in the environment it develops into a sheathed phalariform larvae. Now the phalariform larva is the infective form. Now these phalariform larva, when a person is walking barefoot or any part of skin comes into contact with the contaminated skin soil, these larvae, the phalariform larvae, will penetrate through the skin. They will enter into bloodstream and lymphatic system, and through this they will reach the heart. From the right side of the heart, they will reach the lungs, as we see with Ascaris. Here again the same thing is happening. However, here the larvae have entered directly from the skin, while in case of Ascaris the person had ingested the eggs. So here they directly enter into blood or lymphatic system, reach the right side of heart. From here they reach the lungs. From the capillaries they will come out and enter into bronchioles and bronchi, subsequently in trachea. They move up, they are cupped up, they are swallowed back, reach the esophagus, further down into the small intestine, and then they will develop into adult worms and start laying eggs. So life cycle is very similar to Ascaris, however the entry point is different, and finally they are going to settle in the same place, which is jejunum, is the preferred habitat for these worms. However, they may be found in other parts of small intestine as well. So when we see transmission of infections, the percutaneous route is the route of infection for both these ankylostoma duodenal and Nicator americanus. However, besides the percutaneous route, ankylostoma duodenal may also cause infection by the oral route due to the ingestion of phalariform larvae contaminating the food or water. Or it could be a translactational via breast milk. This is again a possibility which has been reported with the hookworm, particularly ankylostoma duodenal. And transplacental route has also been seen, which is a very rare phenomena noted in some cases of ankylostoma duodenal. Now how does this hookworm infection manifest? So chief manifestation or the highlight of hookworm infection is anemia. So this is a classical presentation of hookworm infections. So when the larvae enter through the skin and they move, they cause groundage at the site of entry, and this is more commonly seen with Nicator species. They may sometimes lead to creeping eruption where the larvae move inside the skin for some time instead of going deep and entering into the blood vessels. They keep on moving inside the skin, and this condition is known as larva migraines. We are going to talk about in the subsequent slide. They can also lead to Loeffler syndrome, as we see with the Ascaris lumbricoides, and when there is a heavy load of the larvae entering into lungs. When the adult worms is present in the intestine, they most commonly present with iron deficiency anemia. So this is a microcytic hypochromic anemia picture, which we see with hookworm infections. Average blood loss per worm is estimated to be around 0.2 ml per day for Ankylostoma duodenale, while it is estimated to be just around 0.03 ml per day with Niketra americanus. So when we compare the two, if we see per worm wastage of the blood, then Ankylostoma duodenale causes much more damage in terms of anemia as compared to Niketra americanus. So when we talk about the laboratory diagnosis, this is very similar to that we see with Ascaris worms. We go for microscopy, that is the mainstay of diagnosis, and we demonstrate the characteristic eggs which cannot distinguish the Ankylostoma duodenale from Niketra americanus. So they are identical eggs for both. So if you want to differentiate these two worms, we need either the adult worm or we need the larvae, which we can differentiate. So identification of adult worm is another possibility, which may be seen sometimes by endoscopic removal or during surgeries when we remove a part of the intestine and we find the adult worms, or sometimes the worms are passed in the stool specimens where again we can confirm. If we want to transform these eggs into the larval stages, or we want to concentrate increase the number of these larvae inside the stool when we want to demonstrate them, in those cases we can go for stool cultivation or stool cultures for Hellmann's. Now the one classical technique is Harada-Mori method. There are other techniques as well, but this is the most commonly used method for hookworm disease, hookworm infections. Harada-Mori method is we had discussed this in the laboratory techniques when we talked about parasitological methods in the previous classes. So here we take a tube with a strip of filter paper, we apply some stool in the lower end, and then there is sterile distilled water at the bottom of this container. So when we leave it for some time, the water is carried up by this filter paper, and this water, when it comes into contact by way of capillary action, it reaches this stool, and when the eggs are present here in the feces, they will hatch and the larvae will eventually migrate towards this water. And after you examine this water by preparation of slides, you can demonstrate the larvae inside this water, which is there inside at the bottom of the tube. So this is how you can increase the number of larvae and demonstrate the larvae in case you want to confirm the species, because hookworm eggs will not help you to differentiate Ankylostoma from Niketra. So if you want to differentiate species, either you need the adult worms or you need the phyllariform larvae for differentiating them. In blood, you may find eosinophilia, which is a non-specific finding and may be seen with many other conditions. So eosinophilia is one clue again, along with anemia. If you find eosinophilia, so you may have a differential of hookworm in your mind. The treatment, again, we have multiple options available. Albendazole, mebendazole and parenteral pamoate, as with Ascaris lumbricoides, they are again very useful here. And we need to treat anemia as per the case. For prophylaxis, we have to treat patients and carriers, proper sewage disposal, and use of personal protection in terms of boots and gloves while we are moving inside fields and areas where which may be contaminated with the feces of infected people. So here you should be wearing your personal protection so that you don't get the infection. Coming to larva migrants, now there are certain nematode larvae which are entering an unnatural host. They may not be able to reach their normal destination. This is seen when you are not the optimal host for the parasite. It accidentally enters into you and then it is not able to find its way. So they become trapped or arrested at some point in their journey. So because they don't know the way, when they enter your body, they are not familiar with the route they have to follow. They get trapped. So this is how they stay in some part of the body. They are not able to reach their final site, final area where they want to live. And they cause manifestations depending upon the site where they have become trapped. So they can wander aimlessly for weeks to months, and maybe up to 2 years in some cases they have been seen to stay and wandering in an unknown area, which is an unfamiliar area for them. So they keep on moving there and lead to some clinical manifestations. depending on the mode of entry, they may enter through skin, where they lead to cutaneous larva migraines or creeping eruption, or they may enter by oral route, where they can lead to visceral larva migraines because of causing infection in some specific tissues and organs. The cutaneous larva migraines, also known as creeping eruption, happens when the larvae enter through the skin, but they do not penetrate below the stratum germinativum and remain in a serpiginous tunnel. So they remain in the superficial layer of the skin. They keep on migrating to and fro. In the process, they create a tunnel-like structure. So some of these larvae may move slowly and irregularly at the rate of around 1 to 2 cm per day in the tunnel, and eventually they are going to die because they are not able to reach their final area and they are not able to complete the life cycle. Then the typical examples for these worms include some non-human hookworm larvae, for example, Ankylostoma brasiliens and Ankylostoma caninum. Even larvae of Gnathostoma spinigerum and larvae of Stranguloides species may lead to such a manifestation. In case of Stranguloides turcorealis, many times the larvae will move rapidly. They move rapidly in short line at a speed of around 3 to 4 cm per day, that is double the speed of other larva migrants. And here they have also been termed as larva currents, which is a type of cutaneous larva migrants only. It's larva currents in case of Stranguloides turcorealis. However, this journey lasts only for a few weeks, and then the larvae generally either die. Most of the time they are going to meet this fate and they die, and then the manifestations are likely to subside. If you want to treat, thiabendazole, either oral or topical, is the treatment of choice for most of the larva migrants, including cutaneous ones. Coming to our next one, Stranguloides turcorealis, the nematode, which is again having a geographical distribution, which is worldwide. Its habitat is small intestine again. The females live in the mucous membranes of the small intestine of man. Again, mainly they are present in duodenum and jejunum. So adult worms live here. It's mainly the females you will find. And these females are oviviparous. They will give birth, they will lay eggs which are going to hatch immediately after they are released. So when you are looking for adult worms, the females are readily discovered, but males are rarely seen in the specimens. The females are around 2.5 mm by 40 to 50 microns in size. They have a cylindrical muscular esophagus which extends till the anterior one third of the body. The intestine extends till the posterior two thirds of the body, and posterior extremity is pointed. As I said, these are oviparous worms, so they will lay eggs which are going to hatch almost instantaneously. The males are shorter and broader, and you are rarely going to demonstrate males in the specimens in human infections. The eggs of these worms are around 55 microns by 30 microns, but you rarely will see them. They contain larvae, and only larvae are finally seen in the stool specimen when you are going to diagnose the patients. The larvae of the Stranguloides turcorealis are of two types. This is true for most of the nematodes. There are two types of larvae, the rebritiform and the phyllariform. So these two larvae you will find again in the life cycle of Stranguloides turcorealis also. So rebritiform larvae, they have a short mouth. There is a very short buccal cavity here, and they have a double bulb esophagus. So there is a double bulb, hourglass like here you can see. This is a double bulb esophagus you will find in the rebritiform larvae, which helps to identify these larvae. They develop directly from the gravid female, and they are the stages which are most commonly demonstrated in the fecal specimens in case of Stranguloidiasis. So when these larvae are passed out with feces, they undergo further development in the soil, and subsequently they become phyllariform larvae, which are infective to the next host by penetrating through skin as with hookworms. So these rebritiform larvae, either they will develop into phyllariform larvae outside the body, or sometimes in heavy infections they may even develop into phyllariform larvae within the lumen of the host. Now when this happens, these phyllariform larvae may penetrate the wall and cause internal infection, which is a kind of auto-infection. So instead of passing out, they are reinfecting the same host. So this auto-infection cycle may continue for some time, and this penetration may happen either in the perianal region or the perineal skin or inside the lumen of the intestine. So all these possibilities are there where phyllariform larvae can penetrate and lead to auto-infection cycle and subsequently lead to hyperinfection syndrome, where the patient may have these larvae entering into multiple organs. This can lead to persistence and heavy worm loads, and sometimes can lead to mortality in case of patients who are immunocompromised. Phalariform larvae, on the other hand, they when we compare to rabidiform larvae, they are longer and more slender. They have short mouths and cylindrical esophagus, and these are the infective stages which are responsible for transmitting infections by entering through skin, which is a way which is similar to hookworms. So they cause infection in the same way as hookworms cause. When you see the life cycle, here again we don't have any intermediate host requirement. The life cycle can be completed in only single host. It's enough for this life cycle. The change of host is not required. It's a hyperinfective type of development. Even one host, it can auto-infect and continue the life cycle if in case of heavy infection. And man is the optimum host. So what happens is, the man who is infected will pass eggs which are going to immediately hatch. The worms are inside the intestine. These will hatch, and the rabidiform larvae will be passed out along with the feces. Now once out, there are two options for this rabidiform larvae. They either move on to become phalariform larvae after moltings, and these phalariform larvae can infect the next person by penetrating through skin. So if it penetrates skin, it enters through bloodstream and lymphatics, reaches the right heart, from right heart to lungs, and from lungs it can enter into bronchi, trachea, swallowed back, reach the esophagus, and subsequently small intestine, where they develop into adults. The other route the rabidiform larvae can follow is, when they are passed out, they develop into free living males and female adults. Now when this happens, these free living adults can lay eggs again, which hatches to release rabidiform larvae. They develop into phalariform larvae again, and these larvae can again penetrate the skin to continue the life cycle as with the normal cycle. So this is a other diagram showing the same thing. So auto-infection is one thing, where rabidiform larvae transforming into phalariform larvae inside the lumen. So these can lead to auto-infections, where they penetrate through the mucosal lining or through the perineal skin and cause high load of worms inside the body, leading to hyperinfection. So it's a way by which the number of worms is increasing or multiplying inside the body because of repeated infection of the same larvae released by the adult worm living inside the intestine, re-entering into your system. So that is a way by which the worm is increasing its number inside the same body. So this is a condition where hyperinfection syndrome can develop, where multiple organs may become involved besides intestine. And this is particularly a problem when you see with in case of patients who are immunocompromised. Coming to the pathogenicity part, the strongyloidiasis can present with several manifestations depending upon the stage you are dealing with. So it can lead to skin lesions, where while penetrating, the larvae can elicit an urticarial rash at the entrocyte. It can also lead to a linear urticarial wheal around the anus, which is caused by the phalariform larvae. While migrating through the pulmonary tissue, it can lead to pulmonary lesions such as hemorrhages and bronchopneumonia. Also, it can lead to intestinal lesions, where it can present as intractable diarrhea and lead to release of blood and mucus along with the feces. So these are all manifestations you can see with strongyloidiasis. Besides this, eosinophilia may be a finding you may see, but it's a non-specific finding. It may give you a clue about the presence of some parasitic infections, but however, it's not going to confirm whether it's strongyloidiasis or hookworm or some other infection. So eosinophilia is just a clue, it's a non-specific finding. Hyperinfection syndrome, as I discussed earlier, it's a situation where autoinfection leads to high load of parasites, high load of this Strongyloides tacorellis becoming high load inside your body, and then it infects other body tissues and organs, and the patient may present with serious morbidities and may even succumb to this infection, leading to death of the patient. This is more commonly seen in patients who have immunosuppression, which can be iatrogenic, such as administration of steroids or immunosuppressive agents. It may also be seen in conditions such as AIDS. Here the patient can present with diarrhea, malabsorption, paralytic ileus, peritonitis, meningitis, brain abscess, and so on. Sometimes strongyloidiasis can also contribute to gram-negative bacteremia, because when the phalariform larvae are penetrating through skin, the bacteria from the outside which are present on the skin may be carried along with it on the surface, and they may be introduced into bloodstream, and sometimes the patient may also develop gram-negative bacteremia because of this infection. To diagnose, microscopic examination of stool or sputum or duodenal washing or jejunal biopsies. So if you examine these specimens, you may be able to demonstrate the replitiform larvae of this parasite. So this is going to help in confirmation of strongyloidiasis diagnosis. In case you have very few larvae, you can go for cultivation as you did for hookworm disease. Here you can go for culture such as Harada-Mori method, and by which you can concentrate the number of larvae in the stool specimen. In blood, you can find high eosinophil counts, which is a non-specific finding, and you can also go for serological methods such as ELISA, which can give you a hint about the history of exposure to this parasite. However, it may not be able to prove an active current infection. So that is how ELISA have their own place in the diagnosis of strongyloidiasis. So treatment remains the same as with most other intestinal nematode infections. You can use albendazole, mebendazole. Ivermectin is one of the recommended drugs for management. So these are the options you have for treating a case of strongyloidiasis, and prophylaxis remains the same as we discussed for the hookworm infection. Thank you. If you have any doubts, you can send an email to me and I will try to answer those queries. You can also meet me personally if you have any doubts remaining after this lecture. Thank you.